Hello, Niki.
Hello, how are you?
Take a deep breath. Let it all go.
I let it all go years ago.
What do you think about this city and this whole trip?
I had a very nice time. I had a lot of comedy mixed with some nice political moments and some nice romantic moments with a lot of nice dancing and some singing. And
I mean, what more can you ask for, right?
Yeah.
To be able to celebrate.
In the middle of all of this, I haven't had a holiday in like 2 years, right? I mean, I've been locked away, you know, and I was...
Yeah, it's nice to feel like it's normal. Yeah. Everybody's out and enjoying themselves.
And, it was a lovely time. Lucky to be able to take this time to do this as well.
Very lucky.
Many people can't. Many people can't, and many people never even get to go on holiday their whole life, you know?
Many people don't even get to go in the house.
And we certainly have experienced the highs and the lows, and we've certainly gone all the way up to Mykonos.
And we're both homeless at the moment.
If one can say that that is a pinnacle.
But a pinnacle of what?
Well, they say it's like the pinnacle of wealth.
Pinnacle of debauchery.
Oh, right. Wealthy debauchery. Hedonism. And ugliness. But I feel... I feel like there's a change coming.
The children of revolution have spoken.
The change is coming. You know, when I say that, I get goosebumps. Do you get goosebumps?
Sure.
I get lots of goosebumps sometimes. And
that's good, but it means like you're...
I'm inspired.
You're inspired and you're in tune with your senses and your emotions.
Well, that's why I wanted to never lose that feeling. And that's why I separated myself from a toxic environment that I felt like was killing that feeling. Mm. And so I thought I need to go...
What environment was that?
Well, the environment of Manhattan toxicity, upper class toxicity. To be fair, I haven't experienced... That's the world I've experienced in Manhattan. I haven't gone to the Bronx or the Queen. You know what I mean? I haven't had... Wasn't in that kind of environment, so I don't want to say... All of New York, but I'm gonna say,
yeah, because in my neighborhood it was pretty, everybody was pretty sweet,
yeah.
You exactly. Live there, too.
Yeah. Washington Heights seemed different, but the world I know the most is that world, the mean, yes. Toxic upper class world that I felt was destroying my creative soul. So I decided, you know what, if I have to take a hit financially, if I have to struggle. I think that's all right, as long as I keep my goosebumps.
That's a great point. The goosebumps also about the child inside. that should always be. And because we are children, like
nurture the child inside, yes, and let it run free. And that child is a little bit crazy, but you just have to.
There's nothing wrong with being a little crazy.
My mom actually said that. She had to let your inner child go. And I said, well, what if people think I'm crazy? And she said, who cares?
That's a good point. Exactly. And who isn't crazy? There are people who try to
suppress their crazy.
Suppress it. And also,
and they're the most
ones. Yeah, and also portray a false...
Joe Biden with his facelift.
Portray a false self and say, I'm normal, but inside. Meanwhile, they go get beaten up by mistresses and get pooed on. And then they come and...
And do distorted things. And we... We let it all out, I think, in a natural way. And in... We don't constrict ourselves.
Hmm. I think you're right. When we get our sandwich, we should go sit in the sun. Like picnic.
Let's out.
Hi, how are you?
What's going on, Mother?
What do you think about... The grass is greener.
The grass is greener on the other side?
Yeah.
I don't think it is. I think that's a mentality of... scarcity. If you always feel someone's lacking, you always look at the other side, right? But you have to find the joy. There's nothing wrong with going to the other side, but if you're not satisfied, you won't be satisfied on the other side either.
What do you think about sugar daddies?
Sugar daddy, I feel like you definitely have to compromise yourself if you're not in love with him. Well, if you were in love with him, it wouldn't be called a sugar daddy, right? And you have to compromise yourself sexually, mentally, and spiritually. Therefore, you have no integrity left for yourself. So I think a person, most people that have a sugar daddy, if they don't have goals, they have compromised their integrity. As we've heard from friends too. I'd rather be bussing tables than have somebody throwing shade at me and throwing money at me and expecting me to like put on a dildo and ride him.
Yeah, that's saying a lot. I mean, you haven't had the easiest life as well. And I think there's a lot of people who've struggled very much and then...
Come a chameleon, you come and go. So the video was made here in the Mississippi River. That's why I'm excited to be here. There it is.
And, well, a lot of people would take the easy road.
Yes, but there's a price to pay when you take the easy road. And that is... selling your soul? And how do you recover from that?
And the devil always comes back to claim.
Yes, there's a price for it. You pay a price. I think nothing is worth your freedom, your artistic, spiritual, and personal expression. Nothing is priceless. So
can't be replaced.
Yeah. So more power to people who work hard and maintain their freedom and sanity.
It's a big thing to maintain.
And now in the fashion world.
Tell us about your childhood.
Childhood? Well, childhood has many layers.
Well, tell us about the bombs.
The bombs were... And it was an assault fronted by the US government, backed by British, French, German troops. And as a result of supporting Saddam Hussein, which they later turned on him because he did not compromise himself for them. And so they told Saddam Hussein to invade Iran. And one day, out of the blue, as we were school kids, he did. And
in the what decade?
80s. And the war started 1980 till lasted for 8 years. And over a million people were killed.
Wow.
And chemical bombs were used, which were given to Saddam Hussein by German government. Chemical weapons to use on civilians. How twisted is that? Cluster bombs, twister bombs. And we would be sitting at school and the principal didn't know what to do when the bombs would come because we didn't have shelter, so they would just open the door and say, go home. So we would be running in the street screaming to get home.
The school principal.
Yeah, because he was like, I don't know what to do with you. I can't protect you guys. We don't have like a basement or something.
Mm.
And then the worst part was that my cousin was 14 or 13, was with us, and we were all playing. And then we gave him a hug and he left. About an hour later, the planes started bombarding the city, and they would do it 3 times a day. So there was no electricity at night. We had to live in ultimate darkness. So they started bombarding around 6 in the evening, which was a rush hour. And then my aunt, who was there, she fell to the ground. She felt something had happened to him without even knowing. She just fell to the ground and started screaming. I was like, why are you acting like that? She goes, I know something happened to him. I felt it. So we started running down the street and running and running. And it was a scene of apocalyptic measure. Like, you would look at the street and it was covered in glass. This is a huge street, all the way up to the top. It was all glass for miles from the windows that had shattered. Then we got to my aunt's house, right? So we were looking at the house and it's completely split in half. So the front part is gone, but then you see the furniture inside, like a dollhouse. None of this.
Kind of what happened in Florida with that building.
Yeah, except this was bombed. Hello. And then I was like looking at it.
We're filming something.
Sorry. We don't have
sorry.
To. Sorry.
Yeah. Sorry.
And then I couldn't comprehend what was happening because it was too traumatic. So I asked one of the people, I was like, do you know the little boy that lives here? They're like, oh yeah, he was hit. The bomb hit the house in front of them and he was sitting outside by his door. the door hit him in the head, metal door, and cracked his arm, almost severed it. And I saw his mother, my aunt, and I was like, are you okay? And she was talking to herself. Then we went home, and we heard them wailing and screaming the next day as they came back from the morgue, because they told him
he died. How old was he?
He was 13. And that's when we realized we can't stay in the city, so we get on buses, right? A bus. Somebody had a bus and said we can get on the bus. And as we're leaving the city, 4 million people trying to drive out of the city, the planes would come and bomb. Now we're trapped in the highway, right? And they're just telling everybody to turn the lights off and get under the seats in the bus. So we're just like crying, and the bombs are dropping, and every bomb that dropped, the bus would just jump, raise up on the floor like hell. So we would go in the mountains and sleep all night in the bus and then come back to the city.
And the mountains were safer?
Yeah, because it was just, there was no city there. There was just roads and hills, and they would come after the cities, you know? And that's when there was a huge exodus of people migrating. And that's part of, you know, migration when it happens. That it's either live under a constant bombardment and die, or try to find a safe haven. And that's why people, refugees, are really not to blame. And when a superpower decides that they're going to bomb a country, regardless of its civilian population, it's such an atrocity towards the human race, crime against humanity. And the people that have the luxury to live here in the US or Europe have become somewhat desensitized to this pain and the suffering, because the media promotes it as a way of entertainment, and therefore there was a lot of war movies as well, and that the underlying reason for them is to desensitize people and dehumanize certain countries as enemies, and it has worked. And I hope more and more people wake up and question and put themselves in other people's shoes who are under constant threat of violence and unspeakable violence.
And do you think about that in your life, like that time in your childhood? Does it come up in your memory?
It comes up, but I think I have repressed it the best way I could, so that I wouldn't feel, because the feeling of death and destruction all around you, it's something no child has to witness, or no person has to witness. And to be so insensitive, and just because a government is not conforming to your needs or catering to your demands, where you have no respect for them, for their culture, they don't deserve to be bombed. They deserve to be respected. And it's very sad that I feel like some of these these big countries, have no respect for other civilization. But if you think about the Persian civilization, it was way more advanced, and so many things
progressive.
Progressive back before there was any Western civilization really happened. It was before Roman Empire. So
Babylon.
For these powers to just dismiss it and treat them like a 2-year old who has to obey his school teacher is quite grotesque and selfish. Yeah. I hope this light is pretty good, because I have a feeling I'm going to look horrible, but it's okay.
Well, thank you for sharing that.
Thank you. Oops.
Life is a
mystery.
Check it. Summertime. And the living is easy.
fish are jumping, and the cotton is high. Hi, thank y'all so much. Your daddy's rich. Oh, yes, he is. And your mama, good looking.
So, I would like to discuss the issue of celebrities being treated like punching bags for the system. Celebrities being used as a scapegoat for public anger, for a punching bag. People are, you know, angry at society, at the way the setup is, that they're angry at their lives. And then the system goes, oh, just take your anger out on this celebrity. The media does that in a big way. And it's destroyed so many of our celebrities, so many great artists too. I mean, we were just talking about Amy Winehouse, who, poor thing, you know, like one of the greatest talents of our generation, destroyed by media that said, that hounded her till death. And then when she died, they said, oh, well, it was inevitable. She was destined to die. She wasn't destined to die. She could have lived a long life if she just got the help she needed. So, it's really sad in a way. I mean, I don't know about you, but
what's the Russian philosopher Dostoevsky? Dostoevsky said that men has a need to see other human beings destroyed. And the only way to be aware of that or try to eliminate that is by having empathy for people. It's human nature. And I was really thinking about that. That was such a brilliant thing to say at his era.
Yeah, he was dark in a way, but he was such a brilliant artist.
He said, we all desire other people's destruction. Like for some of you, like say for example, watching us right now, you might
think that
saying, who the fuck do they think they are?
And if they were destroyed, maybe you would be better off.
Yes, but you should
develop. If they died, maybe you'd be better off.
Or if you
want to be happier. But you wouldn't be happier. Because no one was happier when Amy Winehouse died. None of us were happier. We had lost a
great. The record company was happy making money out of her.
The record company was happy. The father was happy. And the media was certainly happy because they got a chance to distract the population. And it sold a lot of newspapers and a whole lot of news.
And a whole lot of records.
And they made a whole lot of profit out of her death. The sad part about that is they made a whole lot of profit after Michael Jackson's death.
And Whitney. And George Michael.
One of the greatest talents of our times. And it's like, what a waste. What a waste at the end of the day. Like, the artists could have gone and really created something historic. And that chance was cut off very early on. And I think we at some point need to start questioning all of that. What is wrong with our society that it does this?
And next time, if you're watching us right now and you are feeling maybe animosity towards us and you want us to be erased, try to have empathy for us. Start right there and realize that we, as certain kind of women, have had many struggles. I'm not saying our struggles is greater than yours, but just maybe just like yours. So It's taken a while for us to be able to sit here and share ourselves with you. And the reason we do it is not like we're trying to say we're better, but we just thought we can share some sentiments because we are actually part of the working class and we share your struggles as well. So try to have the same kind of empathy you have for your sister or brother for us, because we are your sisters and brothers and aunts and uncles.
Yeah, and you've walked down the street and you've been scared. You walked down the street and you've been scared.
Of what?
of being abused, of being beaten.
But I'm pretty, I don't get abused, I'm just kidding.
But how
no,
about
I have,
we,
I
how
have.
About we say that? How about we go there?
Let's go. Bring it to my blog, bitch.
You know, because there is something inside of you that's waiting to be let out.
What is that?
Well, this I see this very, very gentle little girl that's been abused and put through it.
Yes, but I don't see my struggles different than other people's struggles.
We've
all been abused, haven't we?
I mean,
can I get an amen, motherfuckers?
All those people working in those factories, they get abused every day. You know, you work in a shitty job, you don't have any money, you get abused every day. Capitalism molests all of us. More or less. But let's question that. How about we start questioning the world a little bit more? You know, it won't fix everything. There still needs to be a movement. There still needs to be a lot of work done. But I'm saying maybe, just maybe, if we started thinking about society a little bit more and about bigger issues a little bit more, maybe we would be kinder to each other. Maybe we would love each other a little bit more. Maybe we wouldn't put all the blame on one celebrity.
Like who? Kim K?
Well, okay, let's talk about Kim K. Let's just go there, right? Kim K, she doesn't add that much to culture. I mean, I think she know, like, I mean, she's built a huge empire of wealth based on dubious practices. You can't say she's a great artist. I mean, we have to be kind of a little bit realistic, right? But
she is growing in some areas.
But
as a human being.
But I'm saying it's not her fault at the end of the day. It's not her fault that our culture is so shallow. It's not her fault that she she has made
it's not her fault that she wants to look like a transsexual.
Right.
Because Kanye West slept with Amanda Lepore. Let's get it out in the open, honey. Let's get real. Kanye
so
West slept with Amanda.
She wanted to fulfill a straight man's fantasy.
And she got the same shape and body as Amanda Lepore.
To please the man. And it's reductive, and it's not...
But maybe she thought that if Kanye wants that, I should be able to give him that. And I'm sorry, you guys, you have to know that that aesthetic is a transsexual aesthetic
but
since the 50s.
Also, what
and now Kim K is doing it, and everybody following.
What I'm trying to say is that at the same time, it's not all her fault. I think at some point we need to start looking at the system. See? And the system is telling you...
to shake it.
To just showing you your ass. It's ass. So you need to question that ass.
Then shake it, that ass.
But no, we're just cute little girls trying to express ourselves about politics and things of that nature.
And just drinking while doing it.
And at
rubbish.
The end of the day,
would
what's
you like
wrong
some?
With that? I mean, we're just trying to be cute.
Wait, don't shake it. So, basically, I wanted to talk about this. Kim Kardashian, no offense to you, you're doing great, but that body aesthetics has come from transgender women, probably transferred to her from some gay makeup artist who told her that.
But also, at the end of the day, what is that? What does it inspire a person to get so much? So, I mean, you have to be insecure on some level to be so obsessed with plastic surgery. But that's a product of our society that makes.
But we have had work done to alter certain parts of our body.
I certainly have a little bit of help from the surgeon's office. There's nothing wrong with that. But maybe, well, but Kim K could also question things a little bit more. I mean, who knows? Maybe Kim K will become the next great communist revolutionist.
Exactly. You know,
never know.
More power to her. The whole point is let and let live. You know, her story is her story. It was meant to be for her.
Well, also, you have to understand American society shoves that idea down everyone's throat and tries to promote that the only thing a person should do is make as much money as possible. So she just followed the popular idea, the popular ideology. Could she question that ideology a little bit more? Sure. Would that be nice? Yeah, but she hasn't had that kind of consciousness or that kind of critical thinking. And at the end of the day, I'm just saying, instead of taking all your anger out on Kim K, maybe take your anger out on Hillary Clinton. or just the system at the end of it. Maybe not even Hillary Clinton.
Yeah, they have to remember that somebody.
But there is a system. We do live in a particular kind of system. A setup. A world that is in a kind, you know. There is a system.
There is an upper hand in the system, the ruling party, that you never hear about who it is. But those are the people who are hoarding and plundering you and putting all the celebrities for your distraction. Presenting
That's what we mean. We don't, you know, when people think of the elite, they think of celebrities. But the point we're trying to get across is
they're the cover-up.
The celebrities, sure, are very privileged, of course, and a lot of them have a lot of money. And sure, of course, they could be more progressive. But at the end of the day, they're just pawns in a much bigger game. And there is a whole other
hierarchy,
a much bigger elite, let's say, a much more powerful elite, that maybe you should question a little bit more,
that are tied to the government.
Evo. And the FBI and things of that nature.
The CIA.
But, you know, President Kennedy in the 1950s said, the CIA is murder incorporated. And I wish I could tear it into a million different pieces and throw it into the wind.
Boom.
And 2 years later, he was dead. So
maybe we should be careful too.
Well,
but we're not that powerful, so.
But I'm just saying, you know, there was a time when American presidents said much more anti-establishment things. And you can't imagine American presidents saying that in this day and age. Because today, the American president is going down on the CIA, not opposing it. So that's some tea for you right there.
Just question your government. Bottom line.
Question
foreign policies.
And question my cleavage.
And question her vagina.
But not too much. Otherwise, I don't want to.
Your camera looks like an owl.
I don't want to feel uncomfortable.
Okay. By the way, we just want to come out tonight and say, I know some of you think we are transgender women, but
we're
not. We are not.
We're just lying to get famous.
And we did it. So tonight we're going to come out to you. We are biological females.
So we can be like Kim K.
We are biological females who actually, I have a daughter that is staying with her father. There you have it.
I'm sorry
to disappoint you.
It's not our fault. We just wanted to be cute.
We just had to make money and cause some sort of stirred up to get some work.
I'm just so sad because I feel like I want to be cute and famous.
I'm on my period as we speak.
I'm bleeding for you.
bleeding profusely.
But don't hate us. We love you so much. We did everything just for your love, and we're here.
We have to survive. But at the moment, to be very honest with all of you, we are homeless, most of us. We're homeless, but partying in New Orleans with the last pennies that we have.
Because the world is fucking mean to us.
Because they think we're trans.
Stop treating trans people like trash.
Stop it. And it starts in our community. You know who you are.
And it just
evil model agent, evil models, and evil editors.
Don't even talk about that. I hate all the model agents. It's like the scum of the earth.
Model agents have to be the most vile creatures.
Human being that has ever been created.
Because they lie, and they cheat, and they steal.
And we just are high fashion by nature. And they told us that we're
not good enough. Not skinny enough.
That we're catalog. Can you believe that? We're editorial gold.
You were never catalog.
We're editorial gold.
You were a Jean-Paul Gaultier and Marc Jacobs muse. What are you talking about?
Thank you. I'm a high fashion model. So fuck all of you.
And even high fashion model, what does that mean anyways?
Exactly. How high fashion is it? And how evolved is the creativity? I don't see that much. I don't see a Saint Laurent. I don't see an Alexander McQueen.
No.
Where are they?
Or a Galliano.
Yeah. Where are they? Well, I'm happy we had this conversation.
I'm very happy we got it out. But we have a lot of things that is just oozing to come out. And she just wants to say, Oh, we should. The worker is going to think we're like,
But we like the working class.
And you guys, read Dostoevsky.
Oh, genius.
Read Tolstoy.
Read Virginia Woolf.
Read Rumi.
Oscar Wilde.
And Mata Hari.
And Leon Trotsky. And things of that nature.
And today we want to salute and dedicate this show to Mata Hari, because she died for your sins. And she didn't deserve to be executed.
Hari Mata Hari. Hari Mata Hari.
It's not Hari, it's Mata Hari.
Excuse me?
Oh, you said there was a cult movement.
Well, I'm trying to sound smart, and she's always making me look stupid.
I can never make you look stupid because you are very smart. And I'm not trying to do that. We are sisters. We're not going to go against each other.
No, you're my favorite cute little girl.
Yes. You know I always support you and compliment you.
You really do. We're sisters.
Sisters are doing it for themselves. Standing on their own two feet.
Coin.
We love you.
Thank you. For... Mwah.
Show your dress to them. There'll be World War III.
So I'm telling you, whatever happens in the next 10 years, remember this. You need to live, tell, tell.
Well, that's what I did tonight. Didn't I tell? Didn't we tell?
About a model who was less abused.
Ooh.
And poor.
What?
And poor.
That's me.
But also there was one that ended up working in a coffee shop.
But that's you.
But there was one in the 80s, I guess.
Oh, Davima, I wanted to say something about our industry. Davima was one of the most beautiful aristocratic beauties of all time. The Richard Avedon's muse. You know the picture with the elephants? Two elephants? That's Davima. She did the movie Funny Face with Audrey Hepburn as a model. Now, she has so many Vogue covers, it's just bizarre. But when fashion was ready to move on to somebody like Wilhelmina that came on, they completely discarded her. And what makes me very sad, I found out that she was working at a pizza parlor at the age of 60 when she died of cancer, penniless. What kind of an industry are you? What kind of a monstrous entity are you? To use and extract somebody's talent and just leave her to die in a pizza parlor? How dare you? And do you really think that
this is it? So that we have to stand
for
this?
Part of fashion? And where is your humanity, goddammit? And you're leaving us high and dry. And you know, all of you know about my talents, but how many of you are really calling me to work with me? Is it because I'm outspoken? Is it because you feel threatened by my conviction? By my honesty? Because I don't play your game? I will never play your game. I'd rather die poor and hungry than give up my principles and live a life of having no integrity. Honey, my integrity is intact. When you're on your deathbed and suffering, honey, there's nobody, none of your fucking fabulous job is going to save you, okay?
How dare you. No,
I'm not coming closer.
I'm not.
I refuse. How dare you.
You're whore. Andreja Pejic, you are whore.
You know what? I'm so fucking tired of you. You need to go fuck yourself. You've done nothing but ruin my life.
And I want to be free.
So shut up and let's go.
Oh.
Did you know that heels are the new corset?
Heels are the new corset? Well, I can tell by the way they torture me.
And you feel oppressed, don't you?
I never feel oppressed because I make the choice. That's the difference.
Are you happy? Are you indecent?
I'm very happy.
But you also seem indecent.
Because I'm free. Freedom is happiness.
And indecency, apparently.
Well, what have I done indecent since we've been here?
But well,
it is a little coy girl.
Well, you've talked to some men here.
That's
at Met.
It.
Well, you need to understand.
Understand me.
We just want you to be safe and happy.
I appreciate that.
In America.
It's an American, all-American girl, I am happy. Nobody can take that away from me.
Are you a sweetheart?
Thank you.
You're America's sweetheart.
I am an all-American girl. With a twist.